Hello everybody and welcome back to the video lecture series on microprocessor and microcontrollers. In our today's class, we shall talk about interfacing the external memory devices such as external RAM or ROM with the 8051. Okay, before we start our topics of today, let us have a brief recap of what we have seen in the last class. In our last class, we talked about interfacing LCDs and interfacing the keyboards with 8051. Specifically, we have seen how exactly that 16x2, that means two lines and 16 characters on each line type of LCD, how we are interfacing with 8051. And we have also seen that how a matrix keypad of 16 keys, that is hexadecimal keypad, how it is interfacing with the 8051. We have also seen that different programs individually for interfacing the LCD and interfacing the keyboard. So all the hardware and the software aspects of interfacing this input device and output device, input device as a keyboard and output device as a LCD, we have seen in our previous lecture. Today's class we will be talking about how we exactly interface the memory devices with the 8051. So let us start discussing this memory interfaces with 8051. Before we exactly see how the memories are interfaced, let us have a brief understanding of the architecture, what is being used in 8051 regarding accessing the memories. So basically, the computer architectures are of the two types. What they are, we will see. Before we proceed here, we shall have a look upon the computer architecture and how does the memory is organized in 8051. The internal RAM ROM, how much it is there, how it is organized, and how we can interface an external RAM ROM with the 8051. That we will discuss. So talking about the computer architecture, as I said just now, there are two types. One is von Neumann architecture and the other is the Hardware architecture. What difference is there between these two types of computing architecture is that in one of these two, that is a von Neumann architecture, you can see here, we have this memory, that is a data memory and program memory, both into a single chip, and there is a single channel of communicating the data and the program codes with the CPU. You can see here one outlink and one inlink, it is there between the CPU and this memory unit. Okay, if you take an example of 8051, 8051 does not have this type of a thing. It has a separate dedicated RAM area and a dedicated ROM area, and there will be internal buses for having communication of data with the CPU and communication of code, program instructions with the CPU. That is what here 8051 is different. So anyhow, this is a von Neumann architecture. Here you see that hardware architecture, which is there generally used in even in our 8051. We have the dedicated channels of communication of between the, that means accessing the data from the data memory, and we have this similar thing for accessing the program instructions which are code with the CPU, in between the CPU and the program memory, which is a ROM. Okay, that is the difference between these two architectures. I'll show the von Neumann again, you can check it out. Here there is a common channel communication between this memory unit and the CPU, where your code and the memory, they are not separated, they are stored in a common area, and the common bus is used for exchanging that data and the program instructions between CPU and the memory. Whereas in this hardware architecture, there are separate dedicated channels, that is buses are there for communicating the data between the memory and the CPU, and program instruction between the memory and CPU. Obviously, this is an advantage in the hardware architecture that we have this type of thing, because simultaneously the CPU can work upon fetching the data and instructions as they are dedicated, having dedicated buses for transmitting those. In von Neumann architecture, it is not possible because it has a common line of the channel or the bus on which the data and the codes has to travel. So they can obviously travel one after another serially, where here it can be parallel, both the things can happen. So this saves a time and makes the processor work more faster. So here in this case, 8051 microcontroller works faster because of this type of architecture. Talking about the types of memory chips available in the market, memory ICs available in the market, there are majorly two of them are there, RAM and ROM. RAM is a random access memory. Generally, most of the times it is used for storing the data. And ROM is a read-only memory. It is used mostly for storing the code. We have computer hard disk is a ROM, and the computer is having a RAM also with it. Okay, RAM generally holds the data for temporary purposes. For an example, a particular task is going on. What all the data is associated with that task will be handled by the RAM memories, and it is very volatile, very dynamically changing. Whereas ROM has a very steady and permanent type of storage where you can just store it. You are putting boot programs, all the boot programs in the computers will be obviously stored onto the ROM. Here, when we talk about the desktop computer laptops, their OSs are loaded on the ROM. Okay, because they have to be there always. Here, I have some list of the different ROM memories available in the market and how it is used. You can see them. It is PROM, programmable ROM, EPROM, erasable programmable ROM, E-square PROM, that is electrically erasable and programmable ROM. We have flash memories, okay, and then we have mask ROMs. The difference between the double EPROM and the flash memories are that flash drive is our pen drives are not flash memories. There in specifically the thing is that if you want to erase and reuse that particular flash ROMs, the whole thing will be erased and you can reuse it whenever you want to reprogram it or rewrite the program on it. I am calling it program because generally the ROMs are used for writing programs or storing programs. In double EPROM, it's electrically erasable. There is a specific area of the memory if you want to erase and rewrite that you want to specify, and that will be blown using the fuses and can be reprogrammed as required. Anyhow, we have these all different types of ROMs available in the market in the computing devices world nowadays. Obviously, here this list shows the progression, evolution in the ROM memory devices. So latest ones are that flash and mask ROMs. Talking about the internal ROM of 8051, we have discussed it. 8051 has a 4 KB of internal ROM. Here you can see that it lies inside the CPU, inside the microcontroller only, not inside the CPU. Inside the microcontroller, 8051 it lies. And here you see that it is having the two communication links, one for transmitting, one for receiving. In this block, it is shown. Now, there is one particular pin in 8051, if you remember, pin number 31, that is EA bar, that is the external access. This pin is very important whenever we talk about memory interfacing with the 8051. Because as such, the addressing capability of 8051 is 64 kilobytes, but internally it has only 4 kilobytes. Now, whenever if I give an address which is within the first 4 kilobyte of memory addresses, it will access the internal memory. And if suppose I am writing a number which is beyond that limit, okay, beyond the 0FFFH address, that time it has to access the external memory. So whenever in general we want to use that thing internally, first 0 to 0000 till 0FFF, and after that I want to use the external ROM, that time this particular pin number 31 has to be pulled to VCC, that is it has to be made 5 volts. Doing so, what happens whenever the program ROM addresses are concerned, the CPU considers the addresses 0000 onwards till 0FFF from the internal ROM, and beyond that the next particular address, that is 1000H onwards, it will take it from the, it will access that code instructions from the external ROM till FFFF. So this is about this EA pin, and at what time it has to be pulled into VCC, that is 5 volts. Now what happens if we pull it down to ground, the same pin EA, if it is pulled to ground, that time there will be no access of the internal ROM addresses, because that time as if we are enabling this EA external access, we are giving the complete access of a program instruction addresses to the external memory. Okay, that is what it means. EA means external access, give the access to the external memory. So this time even the addresses which were earlier used for internal from the internal ROM, that is addresses 0000H till 0FFFH, these addresses also will be accessed with the external IC here and not from the internal ROM. So internal memory will not be accessed, whenever you enable this EA bar signal. How do we enable that one? As it's active node, you for enabling that one, you have to make it ground. Okay. Now let us talk about the different RAM available in the market. Different RAM ICs available. So RAM is a volatile memory, temporary data storage will do it. Okay, and it is very fast compared to the data transfer rates. Is very much faster when compared to the ROM. Now there are three types: static RAMs, NVRAMs, and dynamic RAM. Now before we continue further, let me tell you what is available in the commercial 8051 ICs in the market. Memory in the 8051 microcontrollers, which is internally 128 byte available for the original 8051, that is a static type of a RAM. That memory 128 bytes is a static type of a RAM. Now dynamic RAM and this NVRAMs, nowadays some of them are being used even for storing the program instructions too, or I can say even that the latest flash and E2P ROMs are used for storing the data also. So nowadays there is no such limit of limiting the data storage onto the ROMs and limiting the on the RAM story. Okay, data storage on the RAMs and the code instruction storage on the ROM. That type of a barrier limit nowadays not there because of the development in both the technologies, both the RAM and ROM. But conventionally, ROM are used for storing the program instructions, which are called as program code, code memory, program memory. And RAM is used for storing the data. That's why it is called as a data memory. Conventionally, okay. This is about the internal RAM structure of 8051. We already see the addresses starting from this 00 till 7F. It is your particular 128 bytes of RAM, which is addressable both in direct and indirect way of addressing. And apart from this one, the next another 128 byte space is there, which we are not specifically calling to be as a RAM, but yeah, obviously it's a, as the addresses are continuing from 80H onwards till FF also, it's a 128 byte space, but this time we call this space as a special function registers of 8051. All your special function registers as listed here are occupy this space. Interfacing the external memory with 8051 here, you will see that the design of an 8051 microcontroller is based upon base system is not limited to the internal RAM and ROM. Obviously, there is a choice that you can extend it. That is why the addressing capability is 64 kilobytes. When this addressing capability is 64 kilobytes, and internally you just have a 4 kilobytes of ROM and 128 bytes of RAM. If your application area satisfies that available ROM and RAM inside the given IC, that's fine. Otherwise, whenever you have requirement of extending your RAM and ROM, that possibility is there, and that is what our topic of discussion is about, interfacing the external memory ICs here. Here, talking about how does a memory address is decoded by the CPU. Memory address decoding, how it happens. The CPU provides the address of the data, and here it is the job of a decoding circuit. There will be always a decoding and timing circuits available in the control unit area of a CPU. Whether it is a processor or a controller, the job of that particular thing is that it has to generate and locate the address where the particular data or code instruction is lying inside the memory, whether it be internal memory or external memory in any case. Anyhow, when the case of CPU is of an external memory, it has to enable a certain signal, which is a chip select of that particular external memory block. Unless that chip select is activated, you cannot access that external memory. So generally, this chip select signal or chip select pin of the external memories are been activated by this decoding circuit via some signal. Okay. So here, the data bus of the CPU is connected directly to the data pins. The connections have been explained here, how the connections have been taken for 8051 and the external memory. Read-write pins will be connected to read-write pin for the RAM, because RAM is a data memory. For ROM, we generally don't have this read-write connections, but we have just output enable, as it was explained in the next case also. Okay, in this case, the address buses, the lower bus, lower bits of the address bus, the CPU of the CPU is directly connected to the memory chip address pins, and the upper ones are used for activating the chip select. Okay, CS is a chip select. The next, what are the different pins of 8051 which are involved in this interfacing, the hardware interfacing of an external memory device with the 8051? So here there are this particular 3-4 things are there. That is, your first comes the port 0, which are your AD lines, AD0 to AD7. For interfacing any input output devices, we have seen that the data lines are required. Okay, obviously we have seen in LCD and this keyboard interfacing that how we have used this data lines there. Obviously, more it was in for the output device as LCD. Okay, we have used that port 0. Next is ALE. ALE is obviously required to demultiplex this AD0 to AD7. As we have seen that the AD0 to AD7 contains the address for some time and then afterwards it contains the data. This ALE is being used for demultiplexing that one and storing or latching up the address overall of this AD lines onto the internal latches such that the address stays throughout that machine cycle when the operation is going on of read or write. Upper byte of the address lines, that is, it is available on the port 2, that is A8 to A15. That is also involved for addressing the memory location of the external memory. Then we have this EA and this PSENV are the active low signals. Okay, external access about the external access in detail also we have studied in the earlier slides. We have seen that whenever we want to use the internal memory till first 4 kilobytes and then the external memory, this EA should be maintained as BCC. And if we wish that the complete memory access should be given from the external memory only and not the internal one, that time this external access should be enabled. And what I mean by saying this one to be enabled is should be active. As it is active, now it has to pull to it has to be pulled down to the ground. It has to be made ground basically. Program store enable. This program store enable is another important pin, and we will see as the name suggests itself, program store enable. Program to store program, it is making enable. So obviously this pin will be involved whenever we have an interfacing of external ROM, because in external ROM we store the program. So to store program in the external ROM, we require this pin's help, this signal's help. How exactly is that in the hardware connection diagram I'll show you. Okay. So this about this EA pin we have discussed already in detail also just now. And see these port 0 and port 2, how they are useful. And here if you notice that I did not talk much about 8031. Maybe in the earlier classes I have told you about this. 8031 is same as 8051. The only difference is that 8031 does not have that internal 4 kilobytes of ROM. Otherwise everything is same in this 8051 and 8031. Okay. So in those particular cases, in the 8031, the role of EA becomes very important. Because there is no internal ROM memory, always it has to access the external ROM memory only. And for that one, your EA bar should be grounded. Okay? So it's it shows the role of this P0 and P2, port 0 and port 2 to give an access of addresses, address lines, and the data lines, okay? D0 to D8 and address lines A0 to A15. Next is ALE pin. About this one, I told you that this is used for latching the address available on AD lines, okay, such that the address is stored in the internal latches throughout the instruction cycle when it is going on. Okay, as the AD lines they are dynamic in nature, for some time they have the address on them and after that they have the data on it. So while this transition from address to data is happening, the valid address should not be lost. For that purpose, this ALE will be helping for storing or latching up the lower 8 bits of the address onto the internal latches. PSEN bar, I have told you about this one. PSEN bar, it is used for program store enable. Okay, it must be connected to the output enable of the ROM, because your ROM memory generally stores the code, the program instructions, and to enable that one to read, whenever we want to store that one, we have to give this program store enable signal to that OE, output enable of the ROM. Sometimes this output enable has different names. Chip enable will be named CE, sometimes chip select will be their CS. Okay, like this, they may have different names, but it's an understanding that it's an enabling or the gating signal, basically, that output enable or chip select, which will pick that or make that memory device active. For that, the data transaction can happen on. Okay, then also we require this. whenever interfacing when we are doing, we have talked about ALE 4042, I have talked about EA, we have talked about PSEMR, okay, and we have talked about AEMR, but in this we also require the help of this pin number 3, port 3.6 and 7, that is your write and read pins respectively. Also, okay, whenever we access this data RAMs, which are external data RAM is there, RAM can give the access of writing and reading both, obviously, but read-only memory just gives an output enabled, that means you can just read what is there in the ROM and can program also by using this technique, whether it is an electronic erasable or flash type of programming. We can program it once and every time we can just read it from it. But the RAM, as it is being dynamic, volatile in nature, multiple times you can write it, multiple times you can read it. So for that one, we require the help of these two pins very extensively when we interface the external RAM. Okay, MOVX instruction is there here. I've told you about this instruction. It is used whenever we want to access or get or give data out. Basically saying whenever we want to have a data exchange or data transfer from the 8051 or to the 8051 from the external memory. In between 8051 and external memory, whenever we require a data transfer, this MOVX instruction is used. Generally, whenever internal RAM or RAM type of data, whenever it has to be accessed, we just use MOV. Okay, it is just in making the assembler understand that the data is being exchanged, it is from the external data memory and not the internal. Similarly, we have MOVC also. It is for moving the code byte from the external ROM to the 805. Okay. So this is the interfacing block diagram. You can check it out here. How does this PSEN bar is enabling the ROM, output enable of the ROM, and how all these AD lines, okay, address data lines and the upper byte of address line, that is A8 to A15, how they are connected. You can also see that how the read write of 8051 are connected with the read write of the external RAM memory. Okay, as we have total of 16 address lines, that addressing capability becomes 64 kilobytes. So you can connect a 64 kilobytes of RAM, or you can connect a 64 kilobyte of RAM or ROM, or you can even connect the 64 kilobytes of RAM and ROM each. Why so? Because here PSEN bar and your read write will help you to identify and chip select. Okay, basically can be happened by using this PSEN bar and that thing. So whether you are accessing the RAM addresses or ROM addresses, it will be clear for the microcontroller with this. Okay, obviously 64 plus 64 when I am using, it becomes 128 kilobyte. And for that purpose, we require one more extra bit. Because of 16 bit, we can address up to only 64. We require 17 bits to address 128 kilobytes. So in that cases, that 17th bit will be your PSEN bar. PSEN bar will be active as your 17th bit. It will tell whether you are accessing the external ROM or RAM. Obviously, when this is active, 0, it will enable that external ROM. So addresses access will be of ROM only. So the decoding circuit will take help of this PSEN bar and select between these two memory blocks. We end our discussion of the interfacing of different devices with 8051. So far, we have discussed the interfacing of LCD, keyboard, external memory such as RAM, ROM interfacing. So thank you. See you in the next class. Bye.